Good evening, everyone. Today we have Dr. Sumit Mondol, Assistant Professor in the Department of Life Sciences from Presidency University, Kolkata. He will deliver a talk on bioinvasion, a very important topic in the field of ecology, and it's very appropriate and contemporary in present scenario. So I would like to hand over to Dr. Sumit Mondol to start his talk. So are you there?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry, your sign out হয়ে গেছিল. Okay, thank you, Sitama, for introduction. So let me share the slide. Okay, the slide is visible. Slide is visible.
Yes, sir. You can start.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. Today I will talk a pertinent contemporary society like innovation. It's a menace basically. So today the marine ecologist or the global ecologist are facing few challenges such as like in marine ecosystem, for example, we are facing the problem of overfishing, then invasive species and climate change and overall the pollution. So these all are anthropogenic activities and these all have a culminating effect on the marine ecosystem. And if you see the graphs, that the causes of global species in endangerment, so habitat loss and exotic species are the most predominant. And if you see marine sector also, the exotic species, the studies species red listed are impacted are more than the studies conducted. So this exotic species or alien species have becoming a nuisance for the marine ecosystem. So what is invasive species basically? An alien species whose establishment and spread threatens the ecosystem, habitats or species with economic or environmental harm are generally considered as a invasive species. So what are basically invasive species? So suppose one species is coming from one ecosystem to another ecosystem, are generally called these species invasive. When these species are coming and they are spreading in the new ecosystem. So for example, another terminology used like exotic species. These species are coming from one part of the world to the another part of the world. So and introduced species implies to the introduction but not that much threat, and alien species implies to the introduction to a particular ecosystem. So basically in one from one ecosystem to another ecosystem, the alien species or introduced species first come and then it become like a invasive species. So why invasive species a problematic for the ecosystem, and why the oceanic system, even though they are connected through all the oceans, why not these species are generally invasive in natural scenario? Because in natural colonization, really regional species pool, suppose A to I species are there, so they have some biogeographical filters, then physiological filters, then biotic filter, and finally the local assemblages or endemic species, you can say A, B or C for example. But in anthropogenic activities like for example ballast water exchange or the human or man-made species transportation or from one place to another place is causing the problem. For example, if you see the right side of the graph, that regional species pool A to I, so in the present scenario, if F to I species are introduced from one geographical area to another geographical area without they are coming from one ecosystem to another ecosystem because human introduced them. So that's why the biogeographical filter doesn't have any role to stop that those species from crossing one boundary to another boundary. That's why, for example, again, if they successfully come to the regional ecosystem, and then physiological filter also play a crucial role in terminating them. However, again, if this physiological filter also cannot work properly due to the human occurrence or human doing or bringing those species from one ecosystem to another ecosystem, then finally what will happen, that new species will come to the another from X ecosystem to Y ecosystem. So if you see the marine biological invasion, the establishment of new marine environment of species from outside to its natural range, so just generally the all the oceans are generally connected each other mostly. So if from one region to another region the species comes through ballast water or some other means, then this species becoming a threat to the new ecosystem. So this is called in general ecosystem perspective the niche shifting or the shifting of one species to another species. Next question comes, why these species are threat to the new ecosystem? Because these species have their natural predators or natural enemies in their own ecosystem. So when they are coming from one ecosystem to another ecosystem, these enemies are released. So this phenomenon is called as a enemy release hypothesis. So these species, when it comes to the new ecosystem, they are mostly without the enemies. So the enemy which are controlling them in their natural habitat or their own regional habitat may not have those parasites or any other natural predators in new ecosystem. So this new ecosystem is full or free of any predators or full free of any enemies, so which gives the ample chances to the new species to proliferate. Okay, so the alien to how these species become alien to invasive. So when the species comes to new ecosystem, it doesn't have that much threat to the ecosystem, but when these species become invasive, then it is becoming posing a tremendous threat to the ecosystem. Fortunately, an alien species do not always progress to invasive species because few organisms survives and are able to maintain a steady population to the point of becoming invasive. So if you see the graph, so generally first it is introduced, then phenotypic plasticity will have a barrier, then local adaptation, then finally it becomes the invasive to the ecosystem. So what are the common invasive species traits or points they have, extra points or extra capabilities they have? The ability to reproduce both asexually and sexually, then fast growth, rapid reproductive strategy, high dispersal ability, then phenotypic plasticity, the ability to alter one's growth from to switch from present current condition, then tolerance of wide range of environmental condition, then ability to live off a wide range of food types. So there is these species or these invasive species have the capacity to eat anything. Okay, then that's why they are generally called as a R selected species. So there are two type of introduction. One is intentional, another one is unintentional. So intentional introduction is like mariculture. Suppose we are bringing some exotic species or exotic fishes from another, from one aquaculture country to our country. So then aquarium use, then sea life seafood trade, then live fish bait trade, then seaweeds used in the packaging like baiting. So these bringing the species from one ecosystem to another ecosystem just for the economic perspective or just for the pet industries. Okay, Then unintentional introduction means like ballast water transport from of larvae from one ecosystem to another ecosystem, because these ballast water are required in the ship for just maintaining the balance. So in the cargo ship, when a cargo ship transport the material from one place to another or one country to another country, so they release the cargo in one port and equal amount of volume of water they pour into their ballast tank. Okay, then hull fouling, the hull of the ship carrying different sessile animals. Then canals, like sewage canal is a big example of this bioinvasion, increasing the bioinvasion potential. Then water diversion schemes, like fouling of buoys from if the fouling is buoys from one place to another place disperse, then also the bioinvasion can occur. Then transport of fishing and driving gears, transport of pleasure craft and other small boats, then docks, barges, etc. So these all are doing by human unintentionally. So this is not in our control always. Okay, so these are the routes of some bioinvasion from one place to another place. So if you see that from European to Europe to US or Europe to Asia, most of the this bioinvasion occurs, or most of the maritime ship transports mostly occurs. And from the Middle East also, due to the petroleum. So these petroleum also transport from one place to another through the maritime transportation. So if you see the below graph, these Mediterranean Sea, Black Sea, Caspian Sea, these are the most vulnerable areas for bioinvasion. So this is the ballast water. So if you see the ships, this ballast water generally released into the ports. When the equal amount of cargo is taken into the ship, so this water is released from into the port. However, the International Maritime Organization have some rules and regulation, and all the ship or port authority has to abide by those rules and regulation. So these are the 10 most unwanted species and posing a serious threat to the ecosystem. And if you see the graph of the see this plot, so most of the threats are generally in the European waters or US. So one of the most threatful species is Dracinaria polymorpha, one bivalve. So these bivalves generally comes from the European water to US water. Okay, some due to the ballast water exchange. Another example is that Nemiopsis lady. Nemiopsis lady is a comb jellyfish type, and these species came from the US to the Caspian on Black Sea. And this after coming, this species is a voracious feeder, and this species voraciously feeded the anchovy fishes or anchovy juveniles. So it suddenly within a couple of decades, all the anchovy fishery collapsed in Black Sea areas. Another example is the Chinese mitten crab. This Chinese mitten crab, its origin is from Asia, and it was proliferated and into the Australian waters. So these are the 10 most unwanted or most vulnerable species or most targeted bioinvasive species in the worldwide, and which is transported basically due to the ballast water exchange. So these are the some example which I discussed in earlier slides: Vibrio cholerae, North Pacific sea star, green crab, Chinese mitten crab, red tide, zebra mussel, Asian kelp, then comb jelly, lionfish, and colonial tunicates. These all are examples of this nuisance species. Okay, so do our water is safe? No, I don't think so. So these are the example of some Indian water, some bioinvasive species, like from starting from algae to acidians. So if you see the barnacles, for example, the Balanus amphitrite, this is a origin of west coast of Africa. However, now it is fully recorded in the west coast of India. And then Balanus amphitrite hawaiensis, this is a origin of Malay archipelago and Persian Gulf, but now it is fully covered in Mumbai areas. Okay, so these are the few example. Another example is Mytilopsis salai. Mytilopsis cellae is generally originated in Atlantic waters. Now it is recorded in east coast and west coast of India. And these species is more or less the similar like Dracaenaria polymorpha. So these species is a gregarious species, and these species generally do the hall fowling, and the harbor areas they are fully colonized. Okay, so these type of species has posing a serious impact into the underwater tunnels and underwater oil transportations system. Okay, so that's why this species is becoming a serious threat for future in Indian scenario. So what are the environmental impact these bioinvasive species can occur? Suppose preying upon the native species. So these species, as they don't have natural predators, they what they do, these species are selected species. They proliferate very fast. Their reproduction is very fantastic. That's why they prey upon the native species, and they can eat anything, and decreased habitat availability for native species. So their niche will be squeezed, the native species niche will be squeezed, then additional competition posing additional competition for the native species. Then parasites and disease, these species may bring some parasite and disease from one country to another country. Then for example, classic example we are facing now due to the SARS or COVID-19, so this is mostly originated in China, so somehow it came to our Indian ecosystem or Indian land. Then smothering and overgrowth, as I told in earlier, Mytilopsis cellae is overgrowth. These are gregarious species, and when the gregarious these species gregariously colonized into the hull, the ship speed will be drastically reduced, and ship speed reduced means more oil consumption and more economical loss. Okay, then hybridization and causing genetic dilutions. For example, it may reproduce with the native species, and this causing the genetic dilution of the species. Then changes to ecosystem functioning and changes in the nutrient cycling and decreased water quality. Some species are creating a lot of turbidity into the water due to their movements. Okay, so finally the economic impact. So monetary cost for management, then because once these species are come to your ecosystem, it is very easy to detect. So that is the first. So prevention is better than cure. Okay, so we have to see when this species is coming. That's why we have to have a baseline knowledge about the what are the species or native species we have in our ecosystem. So unfortunately, in Indian ecosystem, we don't have such kind of data sets. That's here comes the issue of nurturing the young taxonomist. Okay, so if these taxonomists are encouraged, so then we have that complete database like European waters, like Japanese water, or like US waters. So they know what species they have into their ecosystem. Then only you can make some for your future. So what type of species or what type of database you generate depends upon that. In future you can tell they have, okay, this species is not our native species, this species has come from something or some places. Okay, then aesthetic and recreational impacts. So if you see the photographs, the seaweeds or kelp is drastically increased into the shoreline, and it will ultimately affect the this tourism. Okay, so then actual losses relative to the impact to the fishery and aquaculture. I told as a classic example in the collapse of anchovy fishery in the Black Sea areas. Okay, then interface with the fisheries because of fouling and tearing of nets, then disruption in the tourism, damage to the infrastructure like fouling in the pipes, buoys, etc. Then cost of cleaning up or control. So for example, in US they are spending millions of dollars just to eradicate the Dracaenaria polymorpha because there is no other solution, because they are in the ecosystem, you cannot suddenly make them go out. Okay, so slowly you have to do the eradication process. Okay, the cost of treatments and quarantine, because if the fouling organisms comes from one ecosystem to another ecosystem, you have to clean the ship hull regularly. Okay, then another example is the harmful algal bloom. So this harmful algal bloom or red tides causing a tremendous effect to human health, like for example Alexandria minutum. So these or paralytic shellfish poisoning, so these have direct impact on the human health. Okay, so then what are the action or responses we can do? So according to that, the first species pathway has to be very much clear to us. It has to be very clear to us so that we can detect, or from which water this it is coming, we have to detect that first. Then the population should not be established, then population spreading should be prevented, and finally it should not happen that ecological health will be disrupted, or finally it may affect the economics also. Okay, so if you see the bottom picture, that exotic species when it comes to the ecosystem may be the few million dollars loss, but when it acclimatized, the economics get increased. And when the invasive species finally established into the ecosystem, then it is a million dollars of expenditure just to control that, or just to eradicate that. So with this backdrop, the from Indian scenario, the ballast water program has been conducted by supported by UNDP and IMO, International Maritime Organization, and Port Authorities of India. So these are the ports has been thoroughly surveyed, and the NIO was the lead role in that. Okay, so I was one part of this program, and we worked in the Marmagao and Mumbai port, and we make the database of those harbors, systematic database. So how do we treat the bus? So is there any solution to how, because you cannot stop the cargo ship, so what you have to do just to control ballast water so that it should not pose a serious threat to the ecosystem. So there are some guidelines made by the IMO, International Maritime Organization, like mechanical system like filtration, cyclonic separation, then electromagnetic space separation, like physical ultraviolet light, cavitation, deoxygenation, then chemical treatment. But all these treatment have some impetus. Okay, so all are not foolproof and it cost effective. So if you want to treat the with million tons of gallons of water with ultraviolet ray, it causes a much more amount of money. Okay, so that's why IMO or International Maritime Organization has suggested something, that when to take the water and where to release the water. Okay, for example, while the ships want to take the water, it should take the water after more than 200 meter deep water. So it should not be in the coastal water, because in coastal water biodiversity is very high, and in the coastal water species are number are very high. So if you release the water or take the water from the open ocean, it may have less chances to get the more species into your ballast water. And if the species comes into the ballast water, their survivability chances are less, because the this ballast water tanks are not so these are hostiles. Okay, so these are not environmentally good, so that's why these species may not survive in those tanks. So if the number of species is less, so another thing IMO suggested, that this water should not be taken from the harbor area first of all, and these harbor areas should not be near to the any aquaculture areas, or these water should not, these harbor areas should not be placed near to the riverine channels. So if riverine channels are nearby, the turbidity is very high. So if you take the more turbid water, then what happened, the sedimentation occurs into the ballast tank. So that's why you have to take mostly clean water. so that the sedimentation rate should be less into the ballast tank. So it will create an unnecessary wettage into the tanks and leaching of the material or like iron. Okay, so and another point IMO suggested that the ballast water taking time should not be during the night time, because as we all know, this species, the zooplankton, generally perform vertical migration or diurnal vertical migration during the night time. So the most of the species come up in the water column during the night time. That's why the more species will be in the water during the night time. So that's why they are suggested. So take the water beyond the 200 nautical miles and or the 200 meter deep water, and this the release should be beyond the 200 nautical miles. So suppose a ship is coming from Australia to India, so they have to release the water to for 200 nautical miles. So, but sometimes what happens if the voyage is very short, this protocol always cannot be followed very strictly. So that's why IMO also suggested that you can do the serial dilution of the water. So suppose a ship is coming from Mumbai to Haldia, okay. So what they do, so from west coast to it is coming to east coast. So what they do, they diluted the water so frequently so that the species should not survive into the new water. Suppose a species is very comfortable in the Mumbai water, so gradually when it comes to the Cochin water or it comes to that Paradip, so this serial dilution will kill this species. So this is a natural type of remedy, you can say. So these, as I discussed earlier, the filtration, ozonation, heat treatment, deoxygenation, gas supernaturation, chemical treatment, ultraviolet radiation, ship designing. So these all are considered in nowadays. However, the best thing is to follow the IMO guideline, because these all are have some constraints, or these are mostly cost not so cost effective. So marine bioinnovation and climate change has a significant relationship, because climatically driven changes may affect both the local and dispersal mechanisms. So the current pattern is changing, temperature is changing, the alteration of the current pattern bring those piece larvae from one place to another place, then competitive interaction between the NIS and the native species, and NIS means nuisance introduced species, then the onset of new thermal optima and different carbonate chemistry, then latitudinal range expansion of the species correlated with the changing temperature. So as we all know that due to the temperature increase in the equatorial area, most of the species are trying to go towards the polar region. Okay, then effect on species richness and correlated extinction of the native species, and some invasions may provoke the multiple effect which evolve overall ecosystem functioning. So along with this thermal elevation, changes in the salinity, ocean motion and ocean acidification also posing a serious threat to the ecosystem, because result in the change in the existing species composition, then unable to adapt to the new environment. So therefore these species will force to disperse to the adjacent habitat or become extinct. Then loss of biodiversity may facilitate the establishment of new weedy or invasive species. So suppose if the species are already in a stress in an ecosystem, they don't have that fighting capacity. So when in this scenario happens that species are in a stressful condition, the other species from other ecosystem have a tremendous chance to eradicate that species and establish themselves. So that's why this climate change or the anthropogenic activity posing a serious threat to the ecosystem and the animals into that ecosystem. And that's why these animals may not always resist or may not always fight back with the introduced species. Then this will pose a more threat to the ecosystem. Then higher survival rate will increase the probable number of individual released at the given place or given time. Okay, so if in an ecosystem 100 species can sustain, so if these species are died, or these species are extinct, or these species are migrated, so it will open up a new area for the introduced species. So then the introduced species will come to that to fill up that gap. So that's why these climate change and the bioinnovation has a direct link. So we have to be cautious about the future climate change scenario and how these invasive species mechanism of establishment will be a great topic to study for the future generation. Then furthermore, the sea level rise also a posing serious threat because of existing wetland and salt marshes will be flooded and die, calling into question the types of communities that will replace this lost ecosystem. Because due to the sea level rise, these animals which are established there, they will be died, and to take up that area, other species may come. Okay, then increased turbidity and pollution resulting from runoff from the land, and although some native species will be able to adapt to the newly created habitat, and the high level of disturbance caused by the sea level rise will render the marine community particularly vulnerable to the introduction of the opportunistic invasive species in future. So the most responsible agencies, or these agencies are taking care of this part, like invasive species. Then International Maritime Organization is the main. Then Ministry of Environment, Central Environmental Authority, Port Authority, Directorate of Merchant Shipping, Coast Conservation Department, Coastal Guard, then Disaster Management, and finally Indian Navy. So if you put it in a cycle, then first, better to prevent it. Okay, so we have to be very careful. So what ship are coming from which port, and this port authority has a regulation, strict regulation. So these new ship, when it is coming to the harbor, they have to report that when they have taken the ballast water and when they released and where they released. So this full mechanism has to be standardized, and the reporting form should be very clear enough so that the port authority can make a decision that from where it has come. So finally, we have to be fight back prevent the bioinvasion in the future climate change scenario also, because as I discussed, the bioinvasion itself is a serious threat, and this moreover, this climate change are intensifying this bioinvasion threat for the future ecosystem. Okay, thank you very much for your kind attention.
Interesting topic, and it was a very nice presentation. Thank you so much. We have some questions from our viewers. The first is from David. He is asking what makes the invasive species so competent compared to the native species to compete in a new environment.
Yeah, that I told in the first 2-3 slides, I think, because when a species is coming from one ecosystem to another ecosystem, it doesn't have any enemy. Okay, so the natural enemies are less. So this hypothesis is called enemy release hypothesis. So if you don't have any enemy which is controlling your population, then you are free bird. Okay. So that's why when these species are coming to the new ecosystem, they have ample food, they have no enemy, and they are highly reproductively successful, and they are gregarious, and that's why they are most of the invasive species have reproductive season, basically 2 or 3 times in a year. So they colonized very, very fast into the new ecosystem, and because as there is no enemy in their in new ecosystem, so their chances of getting established is more, and they are more strong enough than the native species in that ecosystem.
To take new habitat, I don't know the question complete, but
I think he wants to know that how much time it takes to establish into the new ecosystem.
Maybe.
I think so. So it depends. It depends that how many species or the species richness of in an ecosystem, when it is coming and where from where it is coming. Okay. So sometimes the establishment may occur within a decade, or sometimes it may take more than 2 or 3 decades. So it depends. So if a species is, for example, coming from a very less rich environment, or rich where species richness is less, to a high species richness area, or where the competition is very high, so then the success of those species are less. And that's why it's very good phenomenon is there. When is this tropical ecosystem and temperate ecosystem, between these two ecosystem, tropical ecosystem are more less chances of getting new invasive species. That's why the temperate ecosystem is more vulnerable, because in temperate ecosystem the empty niches are more, because species richness is less. So when a ecosystem is highly or densely packed with many species, any new species to establish in that area is quite difficult. That's why we are fortunate enough that our ecosystem is in a tropical ecosystem, and our species richness is very high. That's why what happened, if a species, even though it comes through ballast water to our ecosystem, it may not always be successful to establish, because there is no empty niche into our ecosystem or into our water. So that's why sometimes in most of the cases, even though ballast water releases invasive species in our ecosystem, may not always successful, because they will die in this scenario and they may not proliferate.
Thank you, sir. I think our viewers have got their answers. So thank you very much for this interactive session. It was very interesting, and hopefully we will get more videos and more presentations from you in the coming future. So thank you so much.
Okay, thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.